introduce this next speaker. I'll give her her intro one more time. You all know her from hosting 8 seasons of The Top and another 22 seasons of CBS's Big Brother. And now I am very excited to introduce Julie Chen Moonves. We just have a little lag. We're in the computer world. She'll be here in any moment. And this will all be worth it because honestly, this woman has so much experience and is an incredible person. So let's just give it one more second. She's going to be coming on the screen. And one more moment. I think there's a quote actually that goes along with something like this. It says, no good deed goes unpunished. So there we go. There she is.
Can you hear and see me?
We can see your beautiful face, your beautiful sweater, and I am so excited that we can.
I'm just laughing because, like, I am the worst when it comes to technology. And I thought, oh, they are taking a big risk in asking me to come on, and I have to do everything myself. But here we are.
Absolutely.
I apologize for the mishap earlier. Let's start. Live television, you gotta love it.
Exactly. Well, if this was going to happen to anyone happening to you, you would be the best person because you'd be like, the show must go on. We'll figure it out. So no worries.
Working in television, the worst thing you can see if you're running out of steam on a topic is the stage manager to go like this. Stretch, you know, and you're just
like, oh my God.
I'm like, so, but anyhow, you learn how to vamp after a few years of mishaps. So here we go.
That is definitely something that goes from maybe 100 viewers that we have to millions of viewers. So I can't even imagine what that would be like. Oh my God. Well, that segues us perfectly into this interview because we do want to hear everything about how you were able to reach this point in your life where you are probably the most famous TV host and everybody knows your face. Everybody knows who you are, and we want to hear really how you got to that point to really help our viewers to get some inspiration for 2021. So we're just going to jump into it if it's okay with you.
Absolutely. Well, I would have to say, you know, if you're blessed to have some sort of dream, because I know a lot of people who they say, but I don't really know what I want to do with my life. And, you know, when they say it at like 16, that's fine, right? But then when they're still saying it at like you're well into your 40s, then it could be a little bit scary. I was blessed knowing when I was like 14 that I wanted to be a TV newscaster. You know, back then, I'm 50 years old as of this year. You know, I grew up in New York. We had one local news anchor who was Asian, and I gravitated to her because she looked like me. Now, she doesn't look like me, but you know what I'm saying. And my mother was like, that's what you should do. So mothers have a huge influence on their children's lives. My mother planted the seed and then watered it, you know, being a good tiger mom. She watered it. And so I kind of was like, yeah, I just listened to what my mother says. And she says, I'd be good at this. So I did everything you would imagine. I, you know, worked at the school newspaper. I went to college. I studied journalism. I worked as an intern at various news stations. And you have to quote unquote pay your dues. So the track I kind of went through was starting out covering local news in Dayton, Ohio. I had never been to Ohio prior to my job interview in Dayton. And I signed a 3-year contract there.
Wow.
It was great. You know, after you work 3 years covering local news, you cover everything from county fairs to local board meetings to a fire, breaking news. You're ready for your next gig. And from there, I kind of just started stepping up. I went to New York from there, again, local news. And the great thing about covering local news in New York City is that's the headquarters for all the networks. So good or bad, the the people who run network news are watching you. So if you're out in Brooklyn doing, you know, covering the story of your life and you're just, you know, really great at it, or if you're not great at it, it can work for or against you. You know, someone might say, hey, that's someone that we should maybe look at to bring, you know, to cover news for us at the network level, which means, you know, coast to coast, nationwide. But if you really mess it up, and I've had my, you know, mess ups on the air, just fingers crossed, no one of importance saw those reports, you know, but people could say like, wow, she's terrible. You know, let's not get her. Let's not hire her. So that's kind of how I got to being seen at the right time, at the right place, by the right people, a lot of luck.
You know, it's interesting you say that because it is true. You never know who you're going to meet or who you're going to run into or be introduced to at a party or a workplace or so on. And it's funny because I actually haven't thought about this in a long time in regards to getting dressed up and looking your best. I think I lived in Manhattan for almost 10 years, and there I put makeup on every day. I always looked my best, and you do always run into people. In LA, I've had to kind of remind myself, like, to look my best, get dressed up, realize I can meet people when I go out, and you never know who you are going to run into and how that could lead to something. So I know that's not exactly what you were saying, but it just
reminds me. No, it's quite true, because I'll tell you, when I first left Dayton, Ohio, and I made it to, you know, WCBS, Channel 2, local news in New York, I mean, I was working with broadcasters that I grew up watching, but I was the general assignment reporter, so you never knew when you went into work. Am I going to be covering the floods in, you know, Camden, New Jersey, or am I going to be sent to City Hall to cover something? And the weather was really bad one day, so I wore flat shoes, and they had a thick rubber sole, and it wasn't a sneaker, but, you know, I didn't look dressed to the nines. And the main anchor, she took me aside, and she said to me, Julie, let me give you piece advice. She said, don't dress for the job you have, dress for the job you want. She said, if you ever she was like a big sis to me. And she said, you know, I know you want to eventually graduate from being a general assignment reporter, and you've been asked to fill in on the anchor desk, you know, on weekends, you know, on 4th of July, on Christmas Day, you know, all those times that the regular anchors don't want to work. And she said, if you want to continue down that path, you have to walk into this newsroom looking like an anchor. And I was like, wow. My feet are going to be killing me. And she was like, I don't care.
Well, I think probably the one perk at that time is people weren't wearing Christian Louboutins, and Sex and the City wasn't out yet. So we weren't pushed to wear 3 to 4 inch heels every day. So that's the only positive thing.
True. And then I started coming to work with, like, I just left in my cubby, like rain boots. So if I was sent, I was ready.
Wow. I'm going to actually, we need to make a little post out of that, because I definitely have not been thinking like that in a long time. So that's amazing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, that's life, right? Like, you shouldn't judge a book by its cover, but we're human and you do, you know, like my son's 11 years old. He's like, why can't I get a tattoo? And I'm like, well, how much time do you have? But I'm like, no.
Exactly. Well, my son's 3 months old, so hopefully I have a little bit of time before we get to that discussion. But I would tend to agree with you on that point.
Yeah.
We won't even go there.
No.
Well, so Julie, walk us through a day in your life when you are on set and you're filming. What is it like?
Well, when I'm hosting Big Brother, what you have to know is Big Brother is a live show that it's unlike any other reality show. So Thursday night, I know I'm going to be live on the satellite from our studio here in LA at 6 p.m. going to the entire East Coast. 6 to 7 here is 9 to 10 over there. And so my call time is easy. It's 11:15 in the morning. And I walk in with no hair and makeup, and you go straight into rehearsals. And believe it or not, it's like you barely have time to eat, because the day earlier, we have a script meeting where they say, we think this is what's going to happen on your live show tomorrow night. But because it's live, this script could be thrown out the window. So there are times I walk in at 11:15 and they say, you know, that script that we rehearsed yesterday at the table read is what it sounds like. You sit around a table, or this year you sat at home on a computer and you read the script. They're like, rip it up. The house guests are up in arms. There's, you know, drama. We don't know what we're doing. And so you kind of fly by the seat of your pants. And there are other times it goes pretty much to script, but you go rehearse, you eat while you're getting your hair in curlers and makeup done. And then you're on set, like literally running on set. And then the director is telling you, you know, look camera ready, because we're live in 7 seconds and you're still whatever, you know, texting, like give your phone to the stage manager, and then you're off to the races. So it's a lot, but I kind of love the hecticness of it all.
Yes, that's probably the New Yorker in you.
Yeah, that is true. I mean, even as we're talking right now, it's like I've got two dogs recreating the scene for The Lion King. Like, you know, when like Scar and Mufasa. So, oh yeah, you heard that, right? I've got my mom sitting here knitting. I have my son who just got home from skateboarding going, Mom, Dad. I'm like, all right, just come on in. It's
I love that.
Who cares? It's life.
Exactly. Well, that leads me to the next question here. So you've been doing all of these different television shows. You've done The Talk. You're doing Big Brother. Food is Love. I don't think, are you the host on that too, or are you just producing it?
No, Food is Love is a show hosted by a friend of mine for 35 years or so. Mm-hmm. He is from Denmark and he's a phenomenal chef. This kid, I met him when we were kids. This guy should have been, I felt the next Wolfgang Puck when we first met and he bummed on my couch. He was my cousin's friend. And my cousin said, my friend from Denmark is going to be the next Wolfgang Puck, needs a place to crash in LA because he's promoting a cookbook of his father's, because his father was the pastry chef to the king of Denmark. And my cousin said, can he crash on your couch in LA for like 4 nights? 4 nights turned into 3 months because he met and fell in love with an American girl. And, you know, we as women know sometimes when you fall in love and you get married, your career kind of gets sidetracked a little. And that happened to him. But we reconnected and I said, you know, how come you're not Wolfgang Puck yet? And he's like, well, you can help me out. And he and I put our heads together and he came up with the concept of the show. And I said, okay, I'll be executive producer, which basically means I say, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. His name is Lasse Sorensen. I just go, yes, because I trust him so much. And I help fund it. See, Lion King Part 2 over here. So, and it's a show that's based in St. Louis, Missouri, where he focuses on, you know, an Ethiopian restaurant, a Korean barbecue restaurant, and what it has done for the community and teaching that we might come from all different cultures. We can all get along over a good meal and good conversation. We kind of have more in common than we think. So let's not be xenophobic and not want to have anything to do with someone just because they don't look like us or they don't sound like us. Yeah. Or they don't eat what we eat. Guess what? Like, yeah. Let's expand our horizons. And I feel like we've been at a place in this country where many of us need to broaden our horizons. We need to open up our minds and our hearts to one another. And that's what Food is Love is.
That's amazing. Well, with all of these different shows and all the different sets you've worked on or crews you've worked with and talent and so on, and different personality types, what are the biggest takeaways in regards to surviving in the entertainment industry?
I would say two words will serve you in any industry, but especially in Hollywood and in entertainment, is be humble and be hungry. No matter how
Writing that down.
Yeah, be humble and be hungry. Because, like, I think part of the reason my director at Big Brother this past season said something to me. He and I just met this year. He was brand new to the set. And at the end of the season, he said, I've never met someone like you where you've been in the industry for so long and you still ask people, what can I do to be better? Like, as my director, I'd be like, oh, you think I should do it this way? Or you think I should do it that way? You know, like, what do you think? And he's like, I like that you still want to learn. And I'm like, yeah, you know, if you still think a little bit of insecurity can serve you a long way. Like, I'm still kind of that insecure girl from Queens who was like, I just want to fit in, even though I'm the only, you know, Asian person in the whole public school here, you know, and that's kind of, it keeps you on your toes, you know?
That's unbelievable. So, that's amazing. I did write this down. Be humble and be hungry.
Yeah. Stay humble, stay hungry.
Yes. It's brilliant. Well, with that, maybe this relates to this a little bit, and we kind of alluded to this in the IGTV we did. What is maybe a mistake or a mishap that you did experience on your way, you know, working up the ladder? What happened and what did you learn from it that you can share with our audience?
Well, I wasn't always humble, let's put it that way. I'll tell you exactly.
Wow.
You know, when I was young, well, I'm a very headstrong person. If you ever met my dad, you know, he is like old school Chinese dad, like respect, work hard. He was tough. And I'm a Capricorn. So, you know, those horned animal signs in astrology. I remember early in my career where I wouldn't say I realized quickly. Well, I will say I realized quickly. No, I thought I was smarter than my boss. And I kind of let him know it. And that wasn't so smart. So that was not an act of humility. You're going to go through life where you're going to have to answer to someone in the workplace that you don't have a lot of respect for. But that doesn't make it okay to let them know how you think. You know, I remember thinking, like, I have to take orders from this guy, and like I can run circles around him. Like, I'd be a better news director. And I wasn't so shy about letting him know I felt about him, and that did not serve me. So that was a mistake I made. So I would say my advice is, in life, whether, you know, whether you work or you don't work, you're gonna meet people. Let's say you're a mom and you have to meet other parents at your child's school. Learn how to pivot so that you know your audience and know who you're talking to.
And, oh my God, yeah.
And be respectful of that, of those people. You know, even if you don't see eye to eye with that person, or you're not crazy about that person, try and find a redeeming quality. Because Meghan, you and I spoke about this. I've been leaning into my faith a lot. And I know the Bible says, like, hey, we're all God's children and God created us all. So if I say, oh, I can't stand that guy, God is saying to me, really? Really, Julie? Because, you know, I love that guy. And I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. So that kind of goes a long way.
Yes.
Basically, don't be a jerk.
Yeah, honestly, it's amazing. And it looks like we're running out of time, but I wanted to add one last thing before we end there, because I could talk to you for hours because you're so easy to talk to and such a great person. It's interesting you say that, because something happened once recently with a woman who was doing some work at our house, and my husband didn't understand what happened. And I said, you know, sometimes also the more successful a person is, the less self-importance they have, and actually the kinder they are. And sometimes you have to realize some of the people who are starting out, sometimes they feel more important. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Oh, I know exactly what you're saying, because I won't name names, I'll make it fast. But when I worked in news, you know, network news, we had like people from Clint Eastwood level to like young stars, like coming into our studio to promote their film. And there was one just starting out person who's now very famous, who came in with an entourage of like 11 people and was very dismissive to like all of us underlings, like running around the newsroom. And it, and I realized now, like, hey, let's give that guy a break. He was insecure and he wanted to show like, hey, I'm a big star. And he is a big star now. And I think he's probably changed. He was young. You know, when you're just starting out, you're like, I'm going to act this way. So people are going to be nice to me. I'm going to try and be intimidating. I'm going to show them how important I am. But we were like, look at Clint Eastwood. He came in with like no one, biggest star on the planet, you know? And he was like, hey, where do I go? And I'm like, right here, Mr. Eastwood, would you like to talk? You know? So, yeah. And money makes
amazing.
You more of who you really are. That's another one I heard. Money makes you more of who you really are.
Wow, that's interesting. We could explore that for sure.
I mean, look,
we might have to have you back. There's too much to talk to you about.
Thank you for your patience with me today. I'm so sorry about the technology. My sister is going to be laughing at me.
No. You were amazing. I know Meghan and Chelsea also loved hearing you talk. We could talk to you forever. Thank you so much for being with us. We're honored and really everyone here is privileged to be able to hear from you live today. So thank you so much for being here, Julie.
Thank you for having me, ladies. So good luck with the event,
Thank you so much. Bye for now.
Bye for now.
Bye for now.